Please welcome back to the stage, Greg Rickford.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And I've had an extraordinary opportunity over the past 3 days to do a couple of things that I think are important. One is to be present. As the Minister for Ontario's energy system, to give assurances to you folks that at every available forum or fora that we have had here, that I would participate. The second one is that people in nuclear are cool and love to party. And third, that there's a palpable enthusiasm at this conference that I haven't seen in a long time. It's not to suggest for a moment that there have been necessarily down years for the conference in tone and enthusiasm. Certainly, you face their challenges, and I'll allude very shortly to my history and role in some of the evolution and the opportunity within the sector. But I want to do a couple of things very quickly. First, I want to acknowledge that my Associate Minister of Energy, Bill Walker, the MPP for Bruce Gray Owen Sound, is finally with me today. He had some obligations Thursday and got in last night and was able. Bill, thanks for your extraordinary work. And a guy, you know, I can't steal the Premier's lines, but a real champion and a guy who's actually worked in the sector and has been invaluable. Thank you as well to the Canadian Nuclear Association. I'm truly humbled by the fact that I've been invited here to participate in so many events as a provincial minister, having last spoke here maybe 5 or 6 years ago in my capacity as the federal minister of natural resources. So maybe that's a good place for me to begin. Ladies and gentlemen, it was about 7 years ago that the nuclear sector in Canada faced some specific challenges, particularly as they pertain to Chalk River and some difficult decisions around some aging infrastructure. But some pressing and substantial questions about where medical isotope production would happen in Canada. And a strategic plan, if you will, to ensure that isotope production got on a fast track to modernize, to serve Canadians closer to their homes in vast regions of this country. And done right, the Chalk River facility would, CNL now, would continue to thrive, that it would face some challenges, but we would begin to celebrate our nuclear assets across the country, but in particular here in Ontario. And why not? That makes perfect sense. As we have discussed at this conference and the attendance of everyone in this room, we all know the vital role that nuclear energy plays for us in so many important regards. Ontario operationally is, in my respectful view, the standard, the benchmark for the world to understand how it can operate successfully, how, from a cost perspective, it can supply Canada's largest province with 62% of its energy and only cost us 4%. 40% of its generation, and compare that to other elements brought in over the previous decade and a half have grossly distorted our cost model for delivering electricity to the people of Ontario. I won't beat up on wind and solar in this speech. I'm trying to be a little bit more serious than I have in previous remarks, but the point is that from the perspective of the ratepayer, which is also the taxpayer and who owns significant assets in, for example, Hydro One, and is the sole shareholder in OPG, to say the very least, Ontario ratepayers should expect and should get from their government and from those companies, to name a few, a cost-competitive price point for their rate. And we've discussed at this conference that that is in fact true. And it's happening while some of the largest scale infrastructure projects vis-a-vis our refurbishments are going on. And that's a great pivot, because now I'm not just talking about a world-class safety standard, operational capacity. I'm now talking about refurbishments. We would move quickly to decommissioning. I would circle back to our world-class capacity now, and where I get to be in this exciting opportunity to export a growing complexity of medical isotopes that now cover the diagnostics to the health outcomes and real treatments for people, not just here in Canada and not just more locally across our vast regions, but to export to the world. The sterilization capacity that we have through companies like Nordion, and as we learned yesterday, demand around the world, their ability to meet new market expectations. Kevin even mentioned to me the ability to sterilize health and recreational use marijuana, which has become a high priority for them. Either way, folks, I tried. Either way, folks, you can see now that we have several strategic business units that we can focus on and we can talk about moving forward. So how then do we move to a place where we can talk openly, not just as a sector, but begin a conversation about small modular reactor technology? Well, I think there are a couple of critical elements to it. And I think one of the reasons that we've got so much enthusiasm here at this conference, as much of the discussion has centered around SMR, medical isotope, and various other significant advancements that have moved into the front window of the everyday person's life and that are born from nuclear technologies, we have to come up with a how, a why, and a plan. And that's exactly what our government set out to achieve. And I hope, with the confidence of the people here at this sector, we've moved very quickly to give you the confidence that you need to work with us. In addition to, at a provincial level, cutting red tape, stabilizing costs of government, moving through the energy system to find greater efficiencies, and getting a great response from our partners. I mentioned OPG, Hydro One, and other public utilities. We were interested in the value proposition that some of them would offer specifically in the nuclear sector. And as this discussion evolved, our premier took a keen interest in what was happening in the nuclear sector, but more importantly, what needed to happen. Let me talk in a general sense first. One of the very first actions he took was to follow through on a campaign promise to keep the Pickering Nuclear Generation Station operating until 2024. There are optimization discussions going on, but they must take place with the people most proximal to them in the Durham region, our friends and partners at the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission, and the extraordinary work that they do. But we found an opportunity here through optimization to potentially, subject to our public discussions, save customers up to $600 million and protect more than 7,500 jobs in the province, particularly in the Durham region. That was an important policy option that we would exercise. It's expected to contribute more than $12.3 billion to Ontario's GDP and avoid 17 million tons of greenhouse gas emissions. And that's pretty important in the context of what's going on the front page of every newspaper, and for those who don't read them now, and there's more and more of us, is the lead story on your news aggregate. So there's an incredible opportunity here. Why? What is it you like to say, Michael? Because nuclear energy is, let's say it together, safe, clean, and reliable and affordable, and it truly is. And so it was without pause or hesitation that we committed to these large-scale infrastructure projects and sent a stronger signal than had been done historically that we were committed to these refurbishments, that we were committed to decommissioning, and that we would move forward with plans to lead the country and to lead, hopefully, the world in advancing small modular reactors. So in keeping with that, we also fully support the work that's being done at Bruce Power, the world's largest operating nuclear facility, the planned refurbishment of 6 nuclear units between 2020 and 2033, and long-term operation of the Bruce site is expected to generate $4 billion in economic benefits annually and increase employment by 22,000 jobs per year. In addition to the economic benefits, our nuclear refurbishment program is enabling Ontario's nuclear supply chain to retool, to expand its capabilities and bolster its leading position in the global nuclear industry. And I can safely say that for the most part, our refurbishments, importantly, are on budget and just about on time. And if they're not on time, it's simply because we don't have enough skilled tradespeople to complete that. Now, some view that as an issue. I see it as an opportunity, because across this province, we have a macro challenge to get skilled workers into the workforce. And sometimes it takes a situation like this, Michael and Ken, I'm not sure if you're here now, to make it very real to people how important skilled trades are. Indeed, in the tours that I've been to, and the discussions I had as recently as last night with the Power Workers Union, this is a common challenge and a tremendous opportunity for all of us to address. The opportunities then are limitless, and it seems to me, after being here for a couple of days and having numerous discussions, that we're quickly moving to a place where there is, without question, an opportunity for the province of Ontario to lead this country in SMR technology and its application. So these capabilities depend structurally on some things that I suspect you need and want and should hear from governments. Talking too much about what capabilities SMRs have, we know that they generate clean, low-cost energy, and they have the potential to work in locations where conventional nuclear technology is unsuitable. And we heard from my provincial counterpart, Dustin Duncan from Saskatchewan, and I've heard from the Minister of Energy in New Brunswick, and as well a number of other colleagues across the country, that there is a high level of interest. That should excite this group here today. It should give you the confidence that you need that we understand this as an opportunity, and we are willing to work with you to address the challenges. But there's a couple of really important things that we need to do. Now, some of the buzzwords are fully integrated, working collaboratively. Those are terms that governments like to use. But I think in December, when Premier Ford and the premiers of New Brunswick and Saskatchewan agreed to collaborate on the development and deployment of SMRs through a memorandum of understanding, we finally had a place in time where the nuclear sector and its interests in advancing SMR technology were more aligned than they've ever been. That the sector had done important work in road mapping SMR, certainly on a very, very technical side, but politically, if you will, and the resources that come with it from taxpayers, which raises the challenge, if you will, and the opportunity of the taxpayer being involved in supporting this in some degree, meant that we would start to understand the importance of us all working together. So, Obviously, I heard loud and clear, and I was very relieved when the federal government, through my friend and colleague Seamus O'Regan, made an announcement here that was clearer than perhaps this federal government, in fairness, had ever been on the nuclear sector. I hear a few chuckles out there, but I mean that with the greatest of respect, that they were committed and that there was an announcement to move forward on an action plan for SMRs. And so I had a meeting with Minister O'Regan yesterday to follow up on that. And I invited him to join our process of signing an MOU. Now, I want to manage our expectations, but Minister O'Regan did commit to take a look at the information and the details of these MOUs because we think that they are the critical pathway that's been established with the sector to move forward and bring the technical elements, the political elements, the resources, and ultimately the inertia to move this kind of technology forward. And that I similarly agreed to take a hard look at the action plan and understand what role Ontario would play. Thank you. So let's talk a little bit more about the MOU and the excitement that it has generated. First of all, Saskatchewan, New Brunswick, and Ontario, I think, were the intuitively the first three and most important jurisdictions to become signatories to this important document. For Saskatchewan, obviously, its prominent role around the world for the raw materials, I would say, their exceptional abilities to integrate and include Indigenous communities through companies like Cameco and the provincial government's efforts to work closely with them to build a greater understanding about the opportunity and the fact that Saskatchewan is making its best efforts in planning to move off of the residual but significant amount of coal powered electricity that they rely on. Opportunity. New Brunswick, of course, has advanced technologies in their capacity for generation through nuclear. And Ontario, of course, it goes without saying, has evolved, as I said earlier, to be the place where all jurisdictions in Canada would likely look to advance this technology. Addressing key issues for deployment include technological readiness, regulatory frameworks, economics and financing, nuclear resource management. Is Romina here today? No. And public and Indigenous engagement. Working cooperatively to positively influence the federal government to provide what we thought we heard yesterday, and that was a clear, unambiguous statement that nuclear energy is clean technology that is required as part of the climate change solution, and that we would work cooperatively to positively influence all levels of government to provide support for SMRs as identified in the Canadian SMR roadmap and is requested by the CEOs of OPG, Bruce Power, New Brunswick Power Corporation, and Sask Power. That we would work cooperatively to positively influence the federal government to make changes as necessary to actually facilitate the introduction of SMRs. On that point, I believe, again, as I said earlier, the importance of engagement, not just with communities who, in Saskatchewan, who are an important part of the complexion of the workforce for the nuclear sector's raw materials, but recognize our supply chain through organizations like the Canadian Council of Aboriginal Business. Abraflex comes to mind, NesDede Construction, Indigenous-owned and operated companies that can help be an important conduit for how Indigenous communities and young Indigenous people can move into this workforce, how women in nuclear can be a pivotal part of the opportunity we have to talk about one of the most important challenges but opportunities that SMRs actually face. And that is that for a very long time, and likely to some extent for good reason, those big nuclear assets would be, as Jim Morrison would describe in one of his songs, the hyacinth house, where he bellowed out, "I wonder what it is they do in there." And that's important to understand, because SMRs move those technologies into our backyards, into small communities where they may not have the degree of familiarity that, say, a Durham Bruce Gray Owen Sound might have with the incredible opportunity that nuclear technologies bring. It cannot be that we talk about major resource projects and mobilizing this technology into our isolated and remote communities without considering the people and the communities that we will need to actually move it out there. So I believe, especially when it's likely that our isolated and remote communities and the legacy resource projects that we're thinking about on the horizon just here in Ontario, like Ring of Fire, we have an incredible amount of work to do. And something tells me that women in nuclear, in particular, those leaders would be in the best position to make the general public far more comfortable with an explanation as to why this is an opportunity more than it is an issue. It sounds a bit stereotypical almost, Lisa, when I think about it, but I think it's pretty safe to say that we listen to the people who are most intimate with having raised us in most circumstances. And when they're in leadership roles in the nuclear sector, the general public is likely, in my view, to be far more receptive. So that's why everybody here needs to commit to the Women in Nuclear Conference, October 4th and 8th in Niagara Falls, or you'll take your cue to, I'm glad you're clapping, Michael, because you're going with me, so I'm sure you planned. Ken is too, so it'll be great. But ladies and gentlemen, all to make this point that we have to be all in on this together. That in moving the extraordinary opportunity of SMR technology into the smaller communities and the places where diesel generation is a harsh reality, not just environmentally, but from a cost perspective, that future resource projects in this country could benefit significantly from it. Some of these, the commodity markets are telling us, would come on board sometime within 6 to 8 years. And we need to commit here today, as we've been building up over the past couple of days, to be able to move that all together to line up with some of these extraordinary opportunities. And it's my belief that if we do this the right way, we can meet that opportunity. Ladies and gentlemen, the world is asking Ontario to lead. We heard Saskatchewan tell us in the most explicit terms yesterday that we want something built in Ontario, made in Canada, that we could see work and then move out there. They're not interested in nuclear capacity to sell to other markets. They just want to move off coal. SMRs are part of that solution. We heard yesterday when a young man, well-educated, stood up and asked about his home province and what opportunities would exist in Alberta. And I reminded him that the Premier and the Minister of Energy, my dear friend Sonia Savage, stood ready to be part of the second round of signatories to this critical pathway or the memorandum of understanding that charts a path forward for us to do it. And folks, there are other provinces and territories that we believe, and I've heard from directly, that have at least an expression of interest. But at the end of the day, it all comes home to Ontario and this country. I know folks here have come from around the world, but one of the reasons that you're attending this conference here today is because you understand the significant opportunity that this great province has for nuclear technologies, not just to supply our electricity, not just to refurbish our existing assets, but to export that to the world, to show the world how to decommission. And the United Kingdom is looking at this prospect with aged infrastructure within the next 8 years. We have a question. Can we lead that? Is that a strategic business unit that we can show our know-how and our expertise that they might draw from? To understand that Canada is the destination for world-class polyvalent medical isotopes that treat the entire spectrum of illness, from diagnosis to treatment, that in sterilization it starts here in Canada, and then to finish, of course, with small modular reactors. We are poised like never before to move ahead with this with all of our partners. And I would encourage you folks here to think and leave this conference with a positive mindset, a framework that we can do. That's not funny, is it? No. That's kind of funny to nuclear people, right? We can do it, yeah. And that we step up to the plate, and we understand our roles and responsibilities, and that by speaking here today, and by listening to Minister O'Regan and some of our other colleagues politically, that you now have the final pieces and the confidence, if you will, to ensure that you have this entire country, from the perspective of government and politics, which sometimes are two distinctly different things, to support you in the important endeavors that you must take. I think that I've covered just about every entity, organization, that we would need to do this, and I would just leave you with a couple of final thoughts. For my part, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's critical that the next important step we take, and this is in keeping with the MOU, is to have a forum at some point, and I've suggested mid-spring perhaps, to have an opportunity to have a very, very focused and disciplined conversation about SMRs. This conference was part of our roadmap to understanding how we could leverage people's interest and enthusiasm, and I think I got it. I think I feel it, that we can move forward to gain more momentum from other levels of government, governments and other provinces, municipalities came up as an opportunity. But to take all the lanes that are working on this and maybe put them into one wider lane and encourage a more focused discussion on SMR exclusively, and start to talk about how Ontario can lead that, how good Canadian technology and companies could lead that, and how our partners around the globe could also be included. So that's the important next step, and we would be able to then, at that point, communicate the next steps of the critical pathway moving forward. So I want to thank everybody for this conference as we close out, for the incredible opportunity to speak to you today, to give you the support, the encouragement, but more importantly, the intellectual and the political assurances that the province of Ontario as a government is on board, is prepared to support you, and is making its best efforts through the leadership of our Premier and Bill and I to ensure that all other governments across this country channel their efforts to make sure that the nuclear sector is in the best position it has ever been to advance all of its technologies, but more importantly and critically, for the purposes of my remarks, small modular reactor technologies. So ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for this extraordinary opportunity to speak here today. My name is Greg Rickford. I'm the MPP for the Great Kenora Rainy River Riding. It's a privilege and an honor to serve my constituents. But by golly, as a Minister of Energy and one of nuclear's biggest fans, to serve you too. Thank you for this extraordinary opportunity.